encouraging Riverstone.
Thank you.
Cool. We are recording this, so. Great. So we wanted to highlight, like, why Riverstone. You know, we wanted to help you see the value in coming here all the way through the continuum and what that can do for you, and just give you some more insight into that. And then just some of the educational value of what our Riverstone curriculum offers, and, you know, how we do the DP, but also how the DP looks here. And just for those of you that are of younger students, the DP stands for the diploma program, and that's the last part of the IB program continuum. So it's kind of the capstone of it. And then we'll go into John Scripps, Brian Bava, and Salma Schwartzman talking about the value of the DP to colleges, college students, and families. Okay, Okay. So we really wanted to just talk about, like, what it is about Riverstone that you're getting, but not only that, like, we were really hoping for some of those younger parents to come today to be able to see the things your kids are doing now in the elementary years are really building up into what we will see them do in the high school and in their last 2 years in the diploma program. So, you know, we really do, everything that we do is rooted in the IB principles and the curriculum the IB presents. And it's really, it is just extremely personalized. Like, we have to have small class sizes here because of what we want to be able to accomplish with the IB. And we want our students to all be asking challenging questions, thinking critically, looking at the connections in and between subjects across those disciplines, and then develop research and problem solving skills. But that's kind of like the IB gist of it. And the IB, it is an amazing educational framework. I think if anyone spends enough time with me, they'll think that I'm like a salesman for the IB, and I'm not, I swear. I don't get like some kickback or anything. But, I've shared this before, that before I really got into being a part of the International Baccalaureate, I myself was, I loved being in education, but I actually was looking at getting out of it because it was pretty discouraging. Some of the things I wanted to see happen that weren't happening. And once I discovered what it looked like, not only at the IB, but Riverstone itself, I realized that, like, there's hope, and it's not just hope, like, it's also awesome. And so Riverstone, we have our five pillars of success, and this is what all of our decisions are rooted in. So the first one is academic excellence. And if you know anything about the IB, that's like, it is just, it's a precursor to it. And so what that really looks like is curricula that develops critically thinking students that are capable of basically holding a conversation with anyone of any, like, experience at a dinner table, and being able to not only hold their own, but be able to engage and ask questions around what that looks like. And so, you know, I think it's important that our students are aware enough of the world and have their own sense of self, that they're able to understand others, but also stay true to their values. And then at Riverstone, we have our outdoor education, which encourages development and skills. And I think anyone that has gone and experienced one of our outdoor education trips, you can see that firsthand. And as you may or may not know, those trips develop as we go through. And that just kind of is, again, rooted in that, you know, so much of the IB education is around being experiential and actually getting out and experiencing the world. And then leadership by example. And I'll show you several pictures here that I wanted to highlight of what leadership looks like at the Riverstone community. And then it's really, you know, starting in elementary school, their units are all units of inquiry that are based around how they engage with the world. Those units of inquiry moving into the MYP are going to just go across each of the curriculum. And they've got key concepts that go across those units of inquiry that are tied to what that PYP does. And then in the DP, that's where we have to take all of the stuff that the students have established as, like, their sense of kind of how they are in the world, and then actually demonstrate that and express their understanding of new content within that diploma program. And I hope that you're seeing that so much of it is starting at that younger year, where we're identifying and helping kids build up who they are and how they're going to engage with the world so that they can understand the world. But again, like understanding their place in that world. And then community and service, you know, we hope that students are going to engage in some sort of community betterment event, and not hope, like that's what we do. We're going to be giving them opportunities to engage in those. And then our school really works with the international understanding. I mean, our dorm in the high school helps with that a lot because we're bringing in so many cultures. But as you can see in our elementary school, we have representation from all over the world, but also that we bring those things in and really lean into helping us understand how people do things differently around the world, which from, you know, in living in Idaho, that's a really unique experience. And I mean, just to highlight, like yesterday, right, we had our high school and middle school assembly, where we had students, not just parents, but we had students come in and share about their holiday traditions in a way that was informative, but also helped us to just grasp and understand what their experiences are like and help, you know, highlight those here too, so that they feel like this is a part of their home. And then really, as with everything in Riverstone, I think it's important to show, not just talk about, but show how this is, you know, we really want to establish a student-led environment. And so I'd like to just show a couple of examples here of what this looks like going from PYP all the way through the DP. So I kind of put together a few slides here, a few pictures, starting with our pre-K advocating for more swings with our head of school, John Gasparini. And then, you know, in the pre-K, like, I mean, this, I'll be honest, I have a unique experience. Stacy and I and John, we all have a unique experience in that we've had kids go through these programs. And so we've gotten to see it firsthand from multiple levels of like, this is my son sharing in front of his classroom he was four at this time, his traditions. And he had to get up as a four-year-old in front of his class and share about what he was experiencing. And that can be pretty terrifying to some kids, right? And then like looking at grade three, they have a Heroes Expo where they're out presenting on who they are investigating and making, you know, fun Albert Einstein presentations. Grade four, Who I Am Expo, right? These are fourth graders who are getting up and they're presenting. I'm sure many of you have gone to some of these expos where they're presenting about who they, like in front of all of these people, what makes them who they are. You know, grade five has the PYP capstone, and that is an incredible experience that is pretty much just year long, where everything that they're doing is culminating into having that experience of going out into the community, finding what that need is in the community. Again, student driven and coming up with a plan, making connections in the community with how they can have an impact. Grade six, you know, they have humanities and English interdisciplinary expos where they're inviting parents in to hear about what it is that they're studying. And, you know, this one was a case study on human impact in the Pampas region. 7-8, this is their design expo in which a student created and then shared his experience with his guitar. And then in the high school, we have service opportunities, personal projects. Juniors have an extended essay research proposal, and then they have an extended essay expo at the end of their senior year. Senior art exhibition. And then, you know, I like to think of this almost, this Meet the Seniors event. If you haven't gotten a chance to go, I highly recommend, we've already had it for this year, but I highly recommend you make it next year, because these kids speak to our school better than anybody else. And they share what their experience is like. And this is truly that like culminating event of just where they get to share what their experience has been like. So I highly recommend this. And there's just no way that I can put together all of the things that happen at every level across the board. And we're always working to improve those. And we've got actions and steps in place where there's more collaboration and all of these things that are taking place across grade levels to make that continuum as like clear as possible. So yeah, I think just understanding that that PYP to MYP to DP, that flow, there's a lot of intent behind how the IB does it, but also how Riverstone works to incorporate those things for our kids. And it really is, you know, you can see the growth in the kids, and it's just, it's a really amazing experience. Okay, so if you want data nerd stuff that I was tempted to throw in here, if you want any data or anything like that about how effective it is in the IB to have your students stay from PYP to MYP to DP to see that total growth and change, I would love to sit and talk with you about it, because there's a lot out there that I could go into more depth on, but I'm trying to reel back my nerdiness a little bit just for the sake of some people. Okay. I should what? I will give some data. I will post out. Yeah, I will post out some data. The data, like our Riverstone graduates, the ones that are going to earn the diploma program are the ones that have been here long. So I put together a bunch of data around like what that tenure, like what happens, you know, the difference is like, even if a student has only been here from eighth grade, their likelihood of earning the diploma is significantly higher. And so I have like actual numbers that I can share with that. But it's really, it is impactful because they're learning how to do these things at such a young age that when they get to their senior art exhibition or they get to their extended essay, is it still hard? Without a doubt. But they, time and time again, and I think Salma will be able to speak to this too, time and time again, they just say, yeah, I've been doing this since I was like in first grade. I'm doing this since I was in fifth grade. Like, I got this. Okay, I'm gonna save any questions for anything until a little bit later. I'm gonna let John share some of the information around how this connects to colleges.
Is this how we advance slides on your computer?
Yeah, right. Yeah, just the lawyer. Okay.
Mm-hmm. A little taller, so hopefully you guys can see me when I go like this. You see a lot of ceiling too, unfortunately. So I'm gonna talk about, as the college counselor here, I'm gonna talk about how this IB education that Brittany was explaining coincides with colleges' admission priorities. And I'm going to talk about how the IB education prepares students and helps families with this transition to college. So I'm going to talk first about, in general, what colleges are looking for in the students that they are considering accepting to their schools. And after I talk about these things in general, I'm going to invite Brian and Madonna, who actually work in this field, to talk about how this works at their actual college. But generally speaking, what colleges are looking for in their applicants are three things. They want to see a strong educational background. They want to see challenges on the student's resume. And they also want to see the student exhibit self-knowledge. Now, in terms of strong educational background, more specifically, what they're looking for is a good GPA, and they're looking for good grade trends. So, you know, the higher the GPA, the better, obviously. But what I mean by grade trends is that they're level or they're moving up from ninth grade through 12th grade. There's not a lot of inconsistency. There's consistency, and there's a direction, a trajectory of improvement. And also what they want to see in the student's educational background is a broad range of classes. So if we think about what Riverstone offers here, it's a lot of support when it comes to how the students are doing in their classes to help them out with their GPA. And it's a lot of individualized attention from teachers. And then it's the excellent range of classes that the IB offers. We have all of the four main subjects that colleges want students to take 4 years in offered from 9th through 12th. So you have a strong English education, you have a strong math education, science and social studies, and then we also have really strong language offerings. And so colleges want to see generally at least 2 years of that. We encourage more. We also encourage students to study the arts so that they can practice creativity and they can practice expression and analysis in more ways than just, you know, looking at data and reporting on trends and taking that sort of analytical approach to information. So colleges will really like to see, and you know, hopefully Brian can, and Rodanos can attest to this a little bit, what the IB offers in terms of its curriculum and how well that prepares students coming in. Now, what I mean in terms of challenges is they don't just want to see students who have 4.0s, 3.8s, 3.5s. They want to see students who took classes that challenged them in the process. So the thing with the IB is you're required to be challenged. Three of the courses that you take have to be at what the IB calls a higher level, which is the equivalent of an honors class at another school or an AP class at another school. And then our standard level classes, I think, are pretty well recognized because they're IB courses as honors level two. That's all very challenging stuff. If you take SL Bio here, it's going to be a very challenging class. SL, you know, Art is a very challenging class across the board. Standard level also brings a lot of rigor. And then extracurricular activities, they want to see students challenging themselves outside of the classroom too. So again, I'm talking about like the students' application portfolio and what they want to have on their resume when they're applying to college and how Riverstone supports that. We have, you know, lots of extracurriculars that we encourage students to participate in through our advisory program, sports, and just the different clubs that students create here and the amount of support that we give them for that. Finally, there's a self-knowledge piece that students have to exhibit when they're applying for college that's really important at smaller schools who want to get to know these individuals who are interested in going to their campuses. Who are these people that we're considering to have come here? We don't just want, you know, students who are out for themselves and who just care about their own interests. They want students who are going to go out and get involved. So there's a lot on a college application that attempts to gauge your aptitudes, your passion, your goals, your values, your ideas. And another reason colleges are interested in your extracurricular activities is they want to see a connection between what you're doing outside of class, what you're passionate about, what your involvements are, and what you say your principles are, and your interests, and your values. What you're seeing here on the right side of your screen is taken from this thing called a common data set that all colleges publish. And if you like data, this is a really fun thing to research at different colleges. And colleges all produce one of these. You go to their website, you type in common data set, and you can see throughout the years how their admissions has changed or stayed the same. You can look at their numbers as far as like who's applying, how many students are admitted, how many accept the offer. And then you can look at this section, which is my favorite, section C7. These are the college's admissions priorities. So this is Brian Nordanos's school, their admission priorities at the College of Idaho, as stated in the common data set here. And you can see the connection between what College of Idaho is looking for in its students and what we offer. So obviously, again, GPA, that strong educational background is an important thing to them, but I know that it's more than just GPA, it's trends. The rigor of education, this is gonna be across the board something that colleges are looking for and we have here, and we can go on down the line. You see that colleges consider application essays important. That's because they wanna know what the student's passions, goals, values, ideas, character is like. And this is something that we ask students to reflect on a lot here. Who are you? What do you care about? I'm also in charge of the advisory program in the high school. And this is something that I've really tried to build the advisory program that we offer around. It's what do you enjoy doing? What areas of work at the school are you passionate about? Might you want to pursue college? What are your goals and ambitions going forward? These are all things we think about. And then every fourth week at the school, we work on service. So this is what colleges are looking for in students' applications generally. What are students looking for in their colleges, right? This works the other way around too. What are their families and they themselves as applicants hoping for as they take the step from Riverstone into college? What should we be providing them? Number one is definitely academic preparation. I'm looking forward to hear Salma talking a little bit as a student who's been here recently. I always love to hear students talk about how they felt walking into the college classroom for the first time after being here at Riverstone. And oftentimes what I hear from my English students, because I used to teach English here, is that you know the classes that we offer here felt very similar in difficulty and in the way students were engaged with by the professor to what they had, especially in smaller colleges, these liberal arts schools that put you in a circle and have you, you know, debate and discuss things on an equal level. So we really focus on academic preparation, and students tend to report that that knowledge that we teach here and the skills that they learn, research, self-management, collaboration, problem solving, these are all things that prepare them well for college. Families, when they come to Riverstone, are obviously looking for, and students too, some competitive advantage in admissions. You know, the IB is an enjoyable experience, but it's a very hard experience. And I think at the end of going through something this challenging, the hope is that it sets you apart, right? And to college, it certainly does. This is something Brian's going to talk about a little bit later as well. But, you know, the IB is an international standardized system so that if you went through it, the colleges have a much more reliable sense of what your abilities are, right? Rather than having, you know, taken the curriculum at a high school that makes up their own thing that colleges might not be as familiar with. So it allows them to compare students and know what they can do much more reliably, similar to the AP and similar in a way to the SAT. It's just a standardized way of getting to know what a student's abilities are. And because we're an IB school, the depth and rigor of the education that we offer is something that colleges can trust very much. Finally, financial and time savings are huge for our students when they get to college. On the financial piece, doing well in an IB school often means that schools that'll offer merit aid will offer it to you more reliably. You're gonna qualify for scholarships more once they see that you're academically successful at a rigorous school like this. And then there's also an opportunity for a lot of credit transfer. So Brittany created this really nice visual from the University of Oregon, where she went onto their website and she looked at the number of credits that you get for the different courses that you that the you know typical student at Riverstone completes. So for your English course at Riverstone, you get credit for three different English courses at the University of Oregon. If you go down the list of the credits that you earn for passing the IB exams at the end of the course at a certain level, it adds up to over 40 credits over a year worth of courses at the University of Oregon. So you can graduate early, which would provide you with that financial savings, or you can just save on time and take that time and apply it elsewhere. So this gives students an opportunity to double major, which is something that is increasingly popular in college. This gives students the opportunity to study abroad and still graduate on time, which I think is a really important experience to pursue when you go to college. This gives you opportunity to do internships and start preparing for a career, and it's just fun. Opening up your schedule to do different things and follow your passions is a big part of why, you know, college is an exciting opportunity in the first place. So I was just wanting to explain there how the diploma program and an IB education more generally is viewed by colleges and how it's helpful to students on their way to college. I'd like to invite Brian and Jordanos up to talk about how this works at their institution, in particular, the College of Idaho.
Thanks.
Yes.
So I'm going to preface my comments by saying I'm incredibly biased. I'm very biased about the IB, and I'm very biased about Riverstone. I was a board member of Riverstone for 9 years, so I've spent a lot of time on this campus and a lot of energy in some of the older strategic plans I was involved in. I love the photos you showed last week, a photo of my daughter as Audrey Hepburn came up. Yeah. And that was one of the, I think, grade three hero unit, grade four. So I wonderful memories about my kids being here, and now that my son's in 10th grade, you know, having started at kindergarten all the way through, and I 100% agree that being able to start in a IB program at a young age gives you all these skills that will prepare you no matter what happens in the DP program and beyond. And then I did the IB 8 million years ago at the United World College in New Mexico. And, you know, I only had the benefit of 2 years in IB, but it really has framed everything that I do professionally and how I have approached problem solving, communication, writing. It's all skills that I learned in the DP program. So, but I want to get my bias out there because I am really biased about this. But I really appreciate the opportunity to come and talk a little bit about the IB at College of Idaho, and in particular, how Riverstone students have done at the College of Idaho. The majority of, I think, our perspective on the IB has come from my experience and then having IB students come to the college over the last probably 2 decades. Our first IB student came in the early 2000s. And we probably have had over 400 plus IB students matriculate at College of Idaho. So we have a lot of experience with IB students and variations of schedules and courses that they took, et cetera. And so I also have like back in my mind somewhere that nerdiness about all this data. And I was telling John earlier, when I started to do a little research for this presentation, I just started going down a rabbit hole about all these Riverstone students who had matriculated at the college and trying to find out more about them. And then, you know, 2 hours later, I really have to do the work I'm supposed to be doing. But I think that experience has really framed how we work with IB students, how we review IB students in the application process. I agree with everything that John said in terms of what's important. I mean, we look at the GPA, we look at the combination of courses and all of those things. But for me, because of the experience that I have had, I know what skills I'm getting from IB students, whether they get the diploma or not. I know that there is you can't go through the IB program and not come out of it with the ability to think critically, to communicate, to write. These skills that you really need to be successful in college and frankly beyond. I mean, I know we don't do math studies anymore in the IB, but I use my math study stuff all the time in my work in spreadsheets and statistics and things like that. And so, you know, those skills, my point being that, yes, we look at all those things, we don't get fixated by them because we know that there are other attributes that IB students are bringing to the college. And that's where for a small college like us, you know, the fit and feel becomes really important. What is it that they're interested in? Are they going to be able to continue those interests and passions at our school? Is it going to be a good fit? And, you know, can they make it academically? And so that has really formulated my perspective and then in turn how I work with our team on evaluating IB students in the process, if that makes sense. IB students in general outperform their peers the freshman year. And I think a lot of it is because of the rigor of the two-year diploma program, the extended essay in particular. I have lots of conversations with IB students and I always ask them about their extended essay because I'm just interested in it. And then they'll talk to me a little bit about my extended essay and then they'll stop and they say, how did you do an extended essay without the internet? There were no computers when I went to college. So we went to the library, you know, we did research at the Library of Congress, but it's so fascinating to hear about students going through that process of research because it's such a critical part of your college experience, no matter, you know, what career you go into or what subject you study. And so, you know, what we've seen is historically IB students coming in and outperforming their peers in that freshman year in particular, because they've had that experience. They've kind of gone through the motions. I'll even attest that my first year in college, actually my first semester in college was my best semester. Then I found some other things to distract me. It wasn't quite as good as my parents would have liked to have been. The other thing that we've noticed is the retention rate. So when we talk about retention rates, in the college world, we're really focused on freshman sophomore year because that's a good indicator of persistence all the way through to graduation. And our IB students have retained collectively at a 20% higher rate than the rest of their peers, which is astounding. I mean, that's huge. And to me, what that says is that we're a really good fit for IB students. A liberal arts college like ours, you know, I feel strongly that the IB is a precursor to liberal arts. It's very similar. You have to study in these different academic areas. You learn about the importance of how maybe a question in one area could be applied in a different discipline altogether. So that interdisciplinary experience and exposure is really helpful. And therefore, students coming into our program where they're asked to study in these kind of four different areas, it's not a foreign concept to them. But that retention rate being so much higher with IB students is really astounding. And even the IR guy, when he sent that to me, said, I couldn't believe that I found this. That's pretty amazing. But I think it does speak to the fact that we are a good fit for IB students because they've gone through this experience and then are continuing with it in the liberal arts. Now, a couple of words of caution, and I love that you found the common data set and you looked through all of that, which is good. I will caution you by saying that there's probably one person in the admission office that filled that out, and maybe not everyone in the admission office who's reading a file is going to feel the same way, but in general, it will be the same. But I want to reiterate that not every college is going to have as much experience with the IB as maybe we do or other schools do. And in particular, the admission counselor who might be assigned to reviewing your son or daughter's application may not have quite the experience. So it's really important to visit campus, to meet with your admission counselor, your student's admission counselor, and ask those questions. You know, how do you value the IB? Are there benefits of the IB? Do you know anything about the IB? Because oftentimes, especially in our profession, there's a lot of turnover with admission counselors. Sometimes they will say, oh, it's just like the advanced placement program. And I firmly believe it is nothing like the AP program. But they'll get into that rut and be like, yeah, it's honors AP and not really put the thought into that combination of bio higher, math higher, foreign language, and how hard that is in the IB curriculum. So making sure that as you're doing college visits with your kids down the road, that you're asking those questions, asking about scholarships, asking about credits, that's all really important. And you shouldn't assume that even though the IB has been around for like 50 years, 60 years, that all colleges and universities are in tune with what the IB is like. Some schools just may not have a lot of IB students. They just may not have that experience. So that's just a word of caution. But at least at College of Idaho, we know a lot about the IB, had lots of IB students, and we really take that into consideration as we're reviewing the students. So if you'll go to the next slide, I was going to talk a little bit in particular about Riverstone students. We've had about 40 Riverstone students matriculate at the college. Actually, this winter, we'll have 6 Riverstone grads on our campus, which is pretty cool. I know your Don was excited about that. And in general, the Riverstone students have done really well. It was interesting as I looked at kind of the range of Riverstone students who've come to the college. Riverstone has evolved quite a bit in the last 2 decades. And we've had students who've passed the IB and done really well. We have had students who haven't passed the IB. We've had students who had 3.9, 4.0 GPAs. We've had students who had 3.0 GPAs. And the common thread, though, has been the preparedness and ability to handle the rigor of a place like College of Idaho. They've retained reasonably well, not quite as high as some other populations. They're at 76% versus, I think, the average for the time frame I was looking at was about 80%, which is still really good. And then academically, they've been kind of around a B-minus average, depending on which program they were in at the college. And also depending on when they came. Again, I think this evolution of students at Riverstone plays a role in the types of students that were attracted to coming to C of I in the early days versus the students that we've been getting in the last like 5 years. I would say the the six or seven students that have come through from Riverstone in these last 5 years have been exceptional. Really, I mean, they've been, those of you who know Patrick Mark, he's one of the best students, best people, honestly, that best person I've ever met. And he's very successful in medical school right now. But Zainab, who's a sophomore, she's such a rock star, involved in everything. If you saw the news about the cultural show that we brought to Boise, Zainab was intimately involved with that. And it's just, she works in our office, so I see her all the time, feel really spoiled, but she has been fantastic. Chloe Scoville, Kimmy Snodgrass, Garrett, you know, they're just at Demetria, I mean, they're all just doing so well. So big plug for Riverstone students coming to College of Idaho, but they've just blossomed in our environment. And I think a lot of it has to do with the experiences that they've had here at Riverstone and the preparedness that they have for the rigors of a small liberal arts college like ours. So I dove a little bit deeper and I put in there, what did they study? I mean, here are typical like liberal arts majors. You've got everything across the board, social sciences, you name it. And for those of you who aren't familiar with College of Idaho, all of our students graduate with a major and three minors, and they study in four different areas. So they'll study in the humanities and fine arts, social sciences and history, natural sciences and math, and then everyone does a professional foundation and enhancements minor. And we really focus on what students want to do in terms of a career, and then work backwards to put together the combination of majors and minors to help them prepare for that career or multiple careers. And so that's where you see this byproduct of kind of different majors, but all, you know, all those students who are studying those different things, they also have two or three minors associated with that as well. And then when I went down the rabbit hole and said, you know what, I think it'd be interesting to know what these students are doing. And I kind of cyber stalked them to find out what they were doing. The range of professions that the graduates from College of Idaho, who are Riverstone graduates, have gone into are in my opinion, very impressive and very broad. You've got everything from a comedian and a writer, to multiple folks who are in medical school or graduated from medical school or in residency in the sciences. The one in Mongolia, gender and social inclusion specialist, I found that to be really interesting in a place like Mongolia. Like, I wouldn't have expected that. Now I'm blanking. Turbat's the last name. His younger brother, Jack, is at college now. But financial analyst, someone working at DraftKings. That was interesting. You can click the next one. I said writer, comedian, head of pricing, working at Idaho Department of Health and Welfare. I mean, this just screams a liberal arts experience and it really an IB experience, right? And so anyway, that's just a little bit of a history of how Riverstone students have done at C of I, kind of our perspective on the IB and Riverstone students in general. I wanted to have your Donna share just a few words. I know Salma's going to speak more about, you know, her experience and preparedness, which is obviously more recent. But Yordanos is a graduate from the third class at Riverstone. And the second class we decided that did the IB, right? And the reason why I asked Yordanos to come is not solely because she's a Riverstone grad and did the IB, but because she is the best I have ever experienced in admissions work. She cares so much about students, works so closely with students, gets to know students. She cares about the ones we don't take, and follows up with them. I mean, she does such a good job. And to John's point earlier about, you know, this relationship between the college and your student, Yordanos epitomizes that. And so I wanted her to just talk briefly about how her experience here and in the IB prepared her for that, and maybe some of the lessons learned, because she really is a great example. She's a phenomenal alum for the school. I mean, I can't say enough about how well she represents Riverstone. And she's been great to have on our team and at the college. I'll have your Donna come up.
Thanks. Okay. All right. Well, For the sake of time, I thought, thank you, Brian, I thought I would focus on two aspects of my IB experience. Because when I think about IB, there are parts that are specific to Riverstone and then parts that are applicable outside of Riverstone. So when I think about my IB experience that's specific to Riverstone, the outdoor education is the part that resonates the most with me. I found that experience very restorative for my mind and spirit. When I came to Riverstone, life was a little bit, life was somewhat stressful, I would say, balancing the IB, being somewhat new to the US, as well as family and just life in general. And so escaping to nature without the distraction of city life was really refreshing and energizing. And so that's the specific part about Riverstone that I still cherish to this day. And then the part that isn't applicable or that is applicable outside of Riverstone as well is just the international aspect of the IB program. I mean, just the idea of studying something that someone else is also studying in places like London, Costa Rica, that is an amazing bond. You talk to an IB student that studied in the US or in Europe, there's a lot of commonalities. But for me personally, what the IB did was validate my life experiences. When my family and I moved to Idaho, a lot of my education had domestic and English focus. And so it wasn't until I came to Riverstone and the IB specifically that I felt like I had a personal connection to my education with experiences that reflected my international background. And so I get really excited about IB students because no matter where you're from, I know from personal experience that you have those resources that give you international perspective. And so I focused on those two examples just to make sure we could hear everyone. But if you have more questions, I'm happy to elaborate more. Thank you.
Great. I am going to put, I'm going to see if I can put it so that Salma is on the screen. And I think once she starts talking, it should put her face up here so that we're not just looking at one thing here. Let's see. So Salma, are you there?
Yes.
There we go. Cool. Okay. So I'd like to introduce Salma Schwartzman. She is a graduate of the class of 2022, correct? Oh, God, thank you. Class of 2022, and she is currently attending Duke. I want to share just a quick thing. Salma, I'm sorry.
Go ahead. You go ahead.
I called Salma this morning to talk with her about this. And I said, hey, Salma, what are you up to? She said, well, I'm leaving an Italian test. I said, Salma, I thought you were taking Russian. And she said, I am. So she is taking both Italian and Russian, and she shares with me that Italian is her easiest class. So, Salma, if you could please, thank you so much for joining us. And yeah, Salma.
Of course, yeah. Just a quick introduction of myself. I graduated in 2022. I was at Riverstone from first grade to 12th grade. I'm at Duke now. I'm majoring in political science and Italian and European studies and a Russian minor. So honestly, I could talk about Riverstone all day. But when I was sort of mind mapping out what I think the greatest benefits have been to me at Duke that I took from Riverstone, I think three really important ones came to mind. The first one isn't one that's talked about a lot, but I think it's actually super important, which the technique and the skill of knowing how to study, actually, I think is something I took away from Riverstone that's been immensely helpful. I think a lot of people I know here in high school were really able to kind of rely on natural sort of affinities in certain subjects to carry them through. But at Riverstone, when you have, and at the IB, when you have more than one large extended project, such as CAS or the IAs for every class or the extended essay or the personal projects in 10th grade, knowing how to plan independently, how to study for 3-hour tests has been extremely helpful, because I know a ton of people who've had to actually teach themselves how to study, and it kind of puts you behind that initial curve when you first get here. I think also something that Riverstone specifically does that I never really thought about until getting here as well was the spiral curriculum, which is where in math or science especially, instead of just covering statistics or something 1 year and then the next year you do algebra and the next year you do geometry and so on and so forth, Riverstone builds your knowledge. So you start small and you build and you build and you build. And so when you get to a class in college where, you know, it may be a statistics class, but you have to pull on a ton of other areas of knowledge. And I have friends here who said, well, I haven't taken stats since 9th grade. I don't really know what I'm supposed to do. For me, it was kind of like, oh, well, I technically took a calculus, you know, focused class my DP year, but we were for sure doing algebra, trigonometry, geometry, statistics. So that is much more recent knowledge that I've been able to kind of pull on. I actually brought a ton of my notes from 11th and 12th grade to college. My suitcases were packed full of books and old notebooks. And I look at those honestly all the time. And then I think also for, this is like speaking on the math and sciences, when you're at Riverstone and when you are like talking about the IB, people often say, that the content of your higher level courses is, you know, can equate to a lot of what you do in a college level course. And for the longest time, I was kind of like, yeah, for sure, that's what they're just saying. And then I was in evolutionary anthropology course my first semester here at Duke. And I was quite frequently emailing and talking to Brittany about certain videos or literature that we just written, because we had done the exact same articles and videos in higher level biology. So that class was heavily overlapped with our evolutionary genetics unit in higher level bio. And that kind of is the first thing I think when getting to Duke that made me realize the content that you do in your higher level courses really is transferable to so many of your college level courses. And even in the kind of classes where it's less X, or you know, 2 + 2 = 4, I mean, like higher level global politics, which I took, those curriculums are a little bit more fluid. But even still, as a political science major, I was able to go to my advisor and the dean of undergraduate studies for my department and say, I took higher level global politics for the IB. Is it possible to skip this intro to international relations course, which I really don't want to take? And he said, yes, because he had that much kind of faith that what we talk about in high level global politics is transferable. I think also overall, one of the huge takeaways from Riverstone is writing. Undoubtedly, the focus that Riverstone puts on writing is far greater than most of the people I know here. I don't think without the John Scripps of the world, I would be able to research and then write 600-800-word essays in 4 days to the extent that I'm able to now. And even right now, I'm writing a paper, a 15-page research paper, and doing all the research within 2 weeks. And had I not had the experience from the extended essay and a ton of the essay writing you do in higher level English or standard level English, that would not have been able to be possible. Because I think at Riverstone, my experience was so much more of just like, here's the assignment, go do it. But rather, they really emphasize structure and breaking down the components of everything that you learn. And so it's not just writing. You don't just learn how to write an essay on the subject, but they teach you how to write an essay period on anything. And so that you're able to then go learn whatever it is you need to learn and write an essay on that. It's very uniform. And I think it makes it so much easier. And then also just kind of like tidbits on the side that I think that are also just important to note in the little time that we have. Is like was mentioned before, the outdoor education program, I think, is so much more important than people might realize. I think it's interesting because you don't think those skills would be easily transferable to the classroom setting because they are so different. But I think the main things you learn from the outdoor education program at Riverstone is dealing with stress in a chaotic environment. Which I think college especially, that's so important because you're on your own for the first time. You're learning independence at the same time as you're learning management and how to deal with this sort of next level of education. And I think the stressful situations that you learn to sort of just reason your way through in the outdoor education program has really transferred here in the sense where you're able to kind of ground everything, look at something from the bigger picture and from an outward perspective. And it's made sort of independent life here at college a lot more manageable. And it also offers, you know, on a more like superficial level, really cool experiences to talk about for college essays. I definitely mentioned those a couple times in mine. And then, I mean, yeah, I think that I could, like I said, I could talk kind of all day. I don't know how much time we have left. And I'm happy to also answer questions from anyone. But I think that's where I'll leave it for now.
Oh, Salma, I just want to let you know, I didn't like prep that, just FYI.
I did see the parental glow
when
she said money.
Yes, that is so true. Salma, you couldn't see my face, but when you said mind map, I literally like went like this.
No, I literally thought of that too, because both Mr. Scripps and Brittany, those were my mind map models.
Yeah, we worked a lot on that. So okay. Well, thank you so much, Salma. I really just appreciate you. I also miss you a lot. We miss you here at Riverstone a ton. So
thank you,
yeah. But as she said, we would like to open up the floor. There's a few people on Zoom as well that I want to make sure have the chance to ask questions should they have them. But yeah, we did want to open up the floor for any questions and also put our emails up should you want to nerd out with me on some data or anything else.
Nicely comprehensive and informative. As a parent of two Riverstone graduates and my kids have gone to college and graduate school and stuff, you know, what John was talking about and economists and Brian and Salma, it's all true. Like, my kids started college after graduating from Riverstone, and we wanted them to go in as freshmen and not bump up, but the college recognize them, their professors recognize them, they're like, you're in the wrong class, you need to be in this aisle. And there was one semester where my oldest took organic chem, calculus, higher level French, and some other insane class. And we're like, should we park? And she nailed it. She had the highest grade in organic chem, and she had straight A's in all of them. And she totally did it, and it was in the writing that they talked about. My kids can write in fluently in local languages, and they did, like Brian was talking about, the minors, they did minors in their colleges. I can't say enough about it.
Thank you, Carl. Any other questions? Anyone on Zoom? And we're happy to, you know, I can also answer anything email, so please feel free to send us an email or anything like that. Anything for Salma or our guests, Brian or Jordanas?
So when you have students moving through the school system here, why are they leaving to not do high school?
Great question.
I have experience with that. My daughter left in eighth grade. And I think at that time, and I know that Riverstone has made some adjustments to account for this. There wasn't, it was a little bit more rigid in terms of the courses that you could take. And there were, she had some more artistic interests and some other things that she wanted to focus on. And so that was really a big emphasis for her to leave and go to public school. It broke my heart because I knew when she was giving up on the IB, but I will say that her 8 or 9 years here, she started kindergarten, very much prepared her, and high school was a breeze for her. But it really was the curricular offerings at that time, and I know that that's been changed. The great work that's been done by the administration here to provide more options for students, because IB sometimes can be pretty rigid in terms of what you can take. And there's been a nice evolution, not just here at Riverstone, but with the IB committee to account for that, because I think of that composition of going into other schools where there are more electives that you can take, for example, more options there. That's just from my personal experience. My son has managed to just find his path here in this state, but our daughter would leave with the tail end of eighth grade.
And if I could as well share just some anecdotal things. You know, I've had a conversation, I have these conversations regularly of kids asking the question, do I want to stay at Riverstone? And I think part of that is why we're giving more talks like these. It's because I don't think people really quite know what all is going on and what it looks like across preschool all the way through 12th grade. And so I don't think it's it's not super intuitive as a parent to see like, oh, the talk they're giving in pre-K is actually prepping them for the talk they're giving in 12th grade. There, you know, as, if you're not an educator, you're not gonna necessarily make that link. So we're trying to be more explicit about that, for one. For two, I think there's also just some misinformation sometimes out there in general around what like colleges are looking for and what they get here. So, you know, when I have this conversation, I've said it, this is kind of my line of saying like, you're kind of staying here more like there's a philosophical approach here where, you know, the IB, you're getting this like 6-course meal where all of the flavors tie together and it's like, nothing happens independent of each other. It's all connected. Whereas if you were to go to the public school, you're getting an a la carte of AP where it's like, you can have this, you can have that, but it's in isolation. And it doesn't make those explicit connections that we're working really hard to make. And so I think there's just a misunderstanding. So I think you've probably noticed there's been a pretty big uptick of us trying to just share, what are we doing here? And why are we doing it? And listening to colleges and hearing them say they need to have more course choice. So we've made those changes.
I would say just one other thing to add is Riverstone with the IB, but also the 5 pillars, doesn't just prepare you for college, it prepares you for life. And that's not what you get in a typical high school experience. Typical high school, I mean, some public schools, it's just about getting graduated and you hope, you know, you're not important to us anymore. A place like Riverstone, because of the type of community it is, with that academic foundation of the IB and all the other pieces that are part of it, prepares you for the rest of your day. It will prepare your students for the rest of their lives, like 100%. And I think those who graduated would say that they're seeing that as they're on their life journey.
Do we do any kind of exit interviews?
As far as like data points?
Yeah, I mean about like people are students are doing.
Yeah, there is a variety of things. I don't look at those exit interviews, so I can't speak to that. I get that information from others, but I know Stacy and all of them are doing a lot of work around that. So I don't know if you want to speak to it.
Yeah, and the admissions team does exit interviews with the things like from the department. I think we have more, I really could do more to the high school, but from last year, any students who were in the high school that matriculated, we only had 3 students of our 125 that left last year. And we gained, you know, more. So in our DP program, we don't rarely have students leave. It's only like if they move or something, generally speaking. So we're not seeing
that, but we made a huge shift last year for choice. So and we moved to kind of making it really clear a distinction in 9 through 12, even though 9 and 10 are the NYP program in 6 through 10, we wanted the high school to feel different and have more choice and have more social opportunities, because that was a big reason in high school that people were leaving, is either choice, like course choice, or social aspects, right? If you've been in a class with, like Salma had been, I taught Salma in fifth grade, actually. And so, you know, you're in that class with that group of kids for, with 30 kids potentially, or, you know, we have classes in the high school are up to 42. So we have the larger classes, but you're with a class with a small group of kids, right? When you're in ninth and 10th grade, you're trying to be like, do I want to be with these kids the whole time, right? You know, they start being really social. And so we are really pushing for more choice. So our courses now cross 9 and 10, and even our electives from 9 to 11, so they're getting to know kids across classes. They can take dual credit classes like at their local high school. We gave them a lot of choice in sciences, language, electives. They don't aren't required to take art. So now all of that expands their social environment, and that really kept a lot of students this last year. And so for us, that's the big reason why people were leaving is social. But again, I really only know.
So once they're in high school, they stay. That's what you're saying. So the last point would be more like at the end of elementary school or middle school?
Why do you think you can stay?
Yeah, I mean, where are you? For middle school students, what I see a lot on an exit survey, I mean, you see a whole catalog of things. But the things that you see most frequently are, I want to go to a school that has like top division sports. Right. Because I want to play football. We don't have football. Or I want to go to, you know, some families want to make choices of, hey, when I've had my great experience at an IB school, when I go to high school, you know, there are people who are like, I don't want to do that level of work. I want to enjoy other things. I want to focus on other things in my life when I graduate from high school. But that expectation isn't something that I'm necessarily interested in, right? And so there's some people who do that. The social aspect is a thing, absolutely. I think that goes across the board, right? Because you're with a relatively small group of students, and sometimes that can be challenging for everybody. Many years ago, I was having a conversation with some seniors, and they're like, you know, dating somebody is not like dating your sister. You know, that was kind of what, that was the comment that somebody said. Yeah. And so it's a strong community, and there's also, you know, choices that you have to make, right? Do I want to focus solely and in a well-rounded way on all these super challenging classes? Maybe that's what I want to do, maybe it's not what I want to do. So people make choices.
Well, and I think in regards to the sports thing as well, I've asked every senior class, every year, I ask them when they've been here, for example, Salma, whatever it might be, the coils, all of them, I ask, yes. Like, why you are happy here still?
Yeah.
Like, how, why, what did you do? So many of them do highlight and say, you know, either they played sports at another school, because they can play in their local school here. We don't offer football, and I would, you know, we're not a sports school. We have some great activities and sports to do, but that is not, like, you're not going to come here to play football. We don't offer it, right? So, is Kim still on? Oh, God. Sorry, Kim. I didn't mean to. We have great sports. We have great things that we can offer. But we don't offer all sports because we want kids to have that opportunity to go and do things, too, at other schools and have that experience. So,
if we don't offer a sport, that means you can go play.
Thank you.
But if you
do offer,
so that's why
we're very intentional about what we offer. So since we have a basketball team, we have the basketball version. You can't go play it. But if we don't offer a sport, if we don't have a soccer team intentionally, because we don't have students who play for Boise High or Timberline or Pinnacle, but we have them, they can do that. So we have many, many students in our high school who do this. I mean, we have. have an day friends and they come to all of our dances. Like I know many students from many of the high schools because it builds more community, right? And so I think that's what we're trying to do, is create our social space and have all the things we've heard today while also still, you know, having connections and, you know, talking to people.
Immersion is really taken in what people have said and made modifications because, you know, the amount of dances and social activities, you know, the middle school was in here the other night watching fucking, you know, there's so many different things that we do that kind of build that.
Somebody, I can't remember who told them this, but somebody said early on when we came here, but in the first grade, that go and listen to middle school, go and listen to high school, go and like attend these kind of meetings, not because we have so much time, but because it kind of helps set like your expectations and where you want to go. Because I think sometimes in the middle school is challenging, like socially, or you have a bad week or something, and it's like it helped for us, it's been helpful to have that vision of why we're here, so that the sports that the kids play aren't here, but that just expand their social circle by playing sports other places. And that means you can have your Riverstone friends and outside. But having, I told people about this because, you know, it was 5 years ago, first time I went to one of them, and it was so beneficial for our family to have this in mind, you know, the benefits and what it is that, you know, this is why we're here. So even then, if whatever social blows up at middle school one week, you just remember that that's normal, and you know it's not always greener if you go to someone's. So I hope that to see what that benefit is. So that's been very beneficial to us. So thank you for having me. It's useful. The more data.
Yeah.
I did have one question about and not having done a whole lot of research in college because it's been so far away. Is there a way or data or information about the classes that you covered in high school? You know, kind of components, how we can start to understand it so that when we do make a decision this spring, if this is the high school or American that we look at, is that online or is that?
Yeah, it will be updated on our website, but actually we roll it out in January, that we'll do a parent meeting like this and we'll go over course choice. And then you have probably about 5 weeks where you get to talk with your student. And then during that time, your student will also have like a move up day. So the eighth graders will move up to ninth grade and get to experience it. The 10th graders go to 11th grade to experience DP. And they get course choices, what they are. They learn like who the teacher is, they get a description. And then they tell us what courses they want to take by like mid-February. And then that's how we make like our staffing model. So like we don't have enough students sign up for an elective. So we did that last year and that was really successful, and so we kind of just expanded on that, and teachers are letting us know right now like different elective choices that they might want to offer next year that we aren't doing. So yes, it is. And the ninth graders our current ninth graders are actually planning the move up date for the eighth graders, so rather than like teachers planning it like we've done in the past, they're very excited for any work from them.
And yes, it is also going to be a website. We're in that transition piece of our new website. So we've got some documents.
You'll get all that. We have a course catalog and all this kind of stuff. Yeah, but we have the website too. I can say,
oh, it's our turn.
Well, last chance on Zoom.
Any, just Jen Ellis just wanted to. She wrote on here like both of the boys have done for that first one and both of you really appreciate that. And just again reiterated that the importance of that Max, this person I think he does boys and high wrestling and track, and then Sam has done a team call, and that they both also do on this stuff. So just like how helpful that's been for socially as well as having up the two sports as well.
Yeah, okay. I'll let everyone go and just thank you again to our guests. And Salma, thank you. She's there. Hi, Salma. Thank you again. We'll talk soon.
Okay. And again, any questions, please let us know. Happy to answer. Thank you, everyone.
Oh.